Please come to order. Good morning. Welcome to the Commissioners of St. Mary's County meeting this date, Tuesday, November 27th, 2018. I am Randy Guy, President of the Commissioners of St. Mary's County. I'd like to introduce the other commissioners. Sitting to my right, Representative First Commissioner District, which includes Ridge, Piney Point, St. George Island, Mr. Tom Jarboe.
Good morning.
Representative Second Commissioner District, which includes Leonardtown, Hollywood, Mr. Mike Hewitt.
Good morning.
Representative Third Commissioner District, which includes Straw Hall, 7th District, Gone Beach, and Mechanicsville, Mr. John O'Connor, unfortunately, is out sick today. Representative Fourth Commissioner District, which includes Lexington Park, Southern California, Great Mills, Mr. Todd Morgan. Seated at the end of this, Dr. Rebecca Bridgen, our County Administrator. On my immediate right is Bonnie Gray, our Recorder. Amy Carter, our Video Media Producer, is behind the glass. Please turn your cell phones off or on vibrate. When you come to the presenter's table, please approach by coming down the center aisle. And remember, this meeting is being televised, so you need to speak clearly and directly into the microphone for recording purposes. In other words, look good. You're on TV. At this time, we'll have an invocation pledge by Commissioner Jarboe.
As I prepare for the invocation, I just want to comment briefly that, you know, recently in St. Mary's County, we've had a lot of issues with hate coming into our community. And the thing that we have to remember as a community is that the police can't combat hate. Our militaries can't combat hate. Hate is internal to an individual. And it's when we push love and peace out of our hearts that hate takes its place. So I couldn't think of anything more fitting today than to talk about St. Francis of Assisi. Born in Italy in 1181, St. Francis of Assisi was renowned for drinking and partying in his youth. After fighting in a battle between Assisi and Perugia, Francis was captured and imprisoned for ransom. He spent nearly a year in prison awaiting his father's payment and, according to legend, began receiving visions from God. After his release from prison, Francis heard the voice of Christ, who told him to repair the Christian church and live a life of poverty. Consequently, he abandoned his life of luxury and became a devotee of the faith, his reputation spreading all over the Christian world. Later in life, Francis reportedly received a vision that left him with the stigmata of Christ, marks resembling the wounds Jesus Christ suffered when he was crucified, making Francis the first person to receive such holy wounds. He was canonized as a saint. It's the same guy who was partying all the time. Was canonized as a saint on July 16th of 1228. During his life, he also developed a deep love of nature and animals, and as we know, he's the patron saint of the environment and animals. His life and words have a lasting resonance with millions of followers across the globe. In each October, many animals in the world over are blessed on his feast day. But his prayer is simple, it's sweet, and it's what we all need to think about. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is discord, union. Where there is doubt, faith. And where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O divine master, grant that we may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Jarboe. I need the approval of the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it. Next, we have a proclamation and a commendation. Proclamation for Giving Tuesday. Catherine Preston and Susan Lloyd, please all come forward.
Susan from the United Way.
My son is 6'7".
You're set.
I'm good.
Slide this way a little. Let's get them more in the center.
Get more in the center.
Better.
I will thank Commissioner Jarboe for his invocation this morning. And as we've been taught, it is far more blessed to give than to receive. And today is Giving Tuesday. And I think that many of us will have our phones ringing wholeheartedly from a number of organizations asking for money for Giving Tuesday. So on behalf of the commissioners, we'd like to say, whereas Giving Tuesday was established as a national day of giving on the Tuesday following Thanksgiving, and is a celebration of philanthropy and volunteerism where people give whatever they're able to. And whereas Giving Tuesday is a day where citizens work together to share commitments, rally for favorite causes, build a stronger community, and think about other people. And whereas it's fitting and proper on Giving Tuesday and every day to recognize the tremendous impact philanthropy, volunteerism, community service in St. Mary's County. And whereas employees demonstrated their commitment to our community by contributing over $9,000 during last year's campaign to the United Way and to the community health charities. This year, employees who pledged to make $2 per pay contribution may participate in Blue Jeans Friday. Now, therefore, we, the commissioners of St. Mary's County, do hereby proclaim November 27, 2018, Giving Tuesday in St. Mary's County, and recognize the United Way of St. Mary's County and Community Health Charities for its involvement in this globally recognized day of benevolence, and encourage St. Mary's County citizens to join together to give back to this community in any way that is meaningful, is personally meaningful, this date, November 27th, 2018. And the floor is yours.
I'd like to thank the commissioners for once again letting me be a part of this for the second year that I've been with United Way of St. Mary's. I'd like to thank all the employees from St. Mary's County and all the people of St. Mary's County for the generous support you give us. I've had a couple of things come up over the last year, made a phone call, and I've never been told no. So you're there to project in giving, but you're also there when the emergency need comes on. And I thank you not only for United Way, but for the 31 agencies that we represent in St. Mary's County. Thank you.
Very good. Anyone else have anything?
I would just thank you, commissioners, for providing us this opportunity, and I encourage employees to consider renewing their pledges or contributing for the first time in our campaign that runs through December 20th. Last year, we contributed more than $9,500, and we're hoping to increase that. And thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
Very good.
Step in front of the
desk. We need to get front, right in the center here in the front of the desk for the official photo.
Side.
You get right in the center.
Okay.
Right in the
center.
Hey, hold the truck.
Next, we're here, unfortunately, to say goodbye for just a short time, I hope. The commissioner has done very well the last 4 years in representing St. Mary's County, especially for his district area. And we're definitely, it's a loss. Hopefully, we got a good person coming in to take his place for right now. But he has done a great deal of work, especially in economic development area. He's worked hard on that, and he's well known in the area of not only, I would say, industrial manufacturing, everything, and the Navy and the military have been a great asset to us in streamlining and getting things pushed forward as far as economic development. And we're going to miss him very much. For the Commissioner of St. Mary's County, officially commends Tom Jarboe, County Commissioner 2014-2018, for exemplary service as a member of the Commission of St. Mary's County for 2014-2018. Your efforts in representing the citizens in District 1, as well as your tireless work in advocating for St. Mary's County, is noteworthy. St. Mary's County is set to reap the rewards thanks to the collaborative spirit you offered during your term. Your dedication has rightfully earned you the community's sincere gratitude, respect, and admiration. We hereby offer sincere best wishes for your future endeavors and ask God's blessing upon you. This date, November 27th, 2018.
Thank you.
Any commissioners have anything they'd like to say?
I'd like to say Tom's been my wingman here for the last 4 years. He's been somebody I could depend upon, actually all the commissioners were. But it was enjoyable to have him because he's a smart guy that can think on his own. And I've always believed this commissioner job is tough, but you've got to be able to think on your own and make decisions from your heart, and he has. It's not about the last person you talk to. It's not about the crisis that you feel is most important. He's a level-headed, even-handed guy, and he's done a great job. Now, I'm going to miss him. But I always say this, because I was in business a long time, I had a lot of great people come and go. You're going on, you're going to improve yourself, I'm happy for you, I'm going to miss you too, but hey, maybe there's another time that this job will fit in your schedule.
Thank you. I just want to echo Commissioner Hewitt's thoughts. Tom and I have been working together probably since our kids were in Cub Scouts together. And it's been truly been an honor not only with him at Cub Scouts, but during our careers as DOD contractors. And I think much of what Mike said is correct. And you know, if it wasn't for much of the initiative and push that Thomas put forth, particularly at the airport, we wouldn't be where we are today. And his vision for economic development has been superb. And you know, I know where he's going to be working, I know where his office is, so I'll be able to go see him. But we're going to miss you, Tom. And as I said, Commissioner Hewitt said, I expect someday Tom's schedule realign itself, and he may be sitting back here again. So we look forward to that. Thank you.
Thank you. And we have one other little gift for you. Something you can hang on your...
Right over the couch in the living room.
Your knee wall, or maybe in your office. Yeah. But we'd like to present
thank you.
Don't put it in the sheet yet.
No, that burns down.
Everything, didn't it?
Wow.
So this is a gift from the commissioners to you, and we hope that you'll hang it in a proper place.
I will. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you very much for everything. You want one more photo in front?
No, let me say something. Oh, I'm sorry. The last time he did it.
Yeah.
You're going
to play Tom then.
Go ahead.
You thought I was done. I'm not done. No, first of all, I just want to say thank you to all the voters and the citizens of St. Mary's County who elected me to serve in this role. I've really appreciated the last 4 years, and I'm honored that you made the commitment to me, and I made the commitment back. And maybe sometime in the future, we'll play again when I'm not overseas so much. And again, the reason I gave the invocation today, I said I was on travel when all the stuff happened in the last 2 weeks. And so that's one of the reasons I think it's a good time for a new person to come in and take care of things who's not on travel all the time. I have personally sat down with Eric Colvin, commissioner-elect. He'll be here next week, so you'll have a younger, better-looking guy. I had a good conversation with him about what to expect, what things are going on in the community, et cetera. And I do think his heart's in it, and he will be a great representative for District 1. So I feel nothing bad about this decision to make to move forward. And I wish you all the best. And thank you to my fellow commissioners, and congratulations on winning your election. I haven't even had a chance to tell them that. So. All right, now we can do the photo.
That would be a photo. Okay.
Thank you very much. And I just want one more shout out. We have great staff at St. Mary's County. Thank you for all your support.
Thank you.
Okay, next we'll go right into County Administrator time. Dr. Bridget.
Thank you, Commissioner President Guy. I bring your attention, Commissioners, to the next two draft meeting agendas. Next week on Tuesday, December 4th, you have your regular business meeting starting at 9 here. At 10 a.m., you have an executive session scheduled to review boards, committees, and commissions. You also have an executive session at 12 noon for land acquisition to be held at the Sheriff's Office. You'll adjourn and then return here at 1:30 p.m. for your first budget work session of FY20. The following week is December 11th. You begin your morning at 9 a.m. with a joint meeting of the Commissioners of St. Mary's County and St. Mary's County Board of Education, and that's held at their offices on Moakley Street. You'll return to the Chesapeake Building for an 11 a.m. business meeting. You do have tentatively put on your agenda the decision for the proposed ordinance for commercial dock use. And then you have an executive session for litigation and then any follow-up and personnel for boards, committees, and commissions. You adjourn for lunch. Come back at, you don't come back. At 1 o'clock, you have your ribbon cutting ceremony scheduled from the Department of Public Works and Transportation for FDR Boulevard, Phase 1C, and an STS bus commissioning, and that'll be held at the First Colony. And then 6 p.m. that evening, you have your joint meeting of the Commissioners of St. Mary's County and St. Mary's County delegation here in this room. Item B on your county administrator item is an anti-hate resolution. The purpose of the request for this agenda item is to approve an anti-hate resolution in response to the racist flyers that have been found in St. Mary's County. There are three items in board docs: your summary memo, the resolution, and the news release that was issued on November 16th. As already mentioned, there were racist flyers discovered in St. Mary's County the week of November 11th. The community took swift action, reporting to the sheriff's office. A unity vigil was held on November 14th with the theme No Hate in St. Mary's County. The commissioners denounced the racist flyers in a news release on the 16th, as well as in their meeting on November 13th. The anti-hate resolution rejects and denounces racism, bigotry, and sexism in any form, and states that the commissioners will use all means within their authority to respond to and address this content. Further, the commissioners welcome all people to St. Mary's and recognize the rights of individuals to live their lives with dignity, free from discrimination based on their faith, race, national origin, sex, sexual orientation, gender preference, disability, or immigration status. So the request today is to approve the resolution that's presented November 27th.
Mr. President, I move to approve the anti-hate resolution.
I'll second it. Discussion.
Discussion.
I went to the unity vigil that night over in the square in Leonardton. And what was really important about it, it wasn't about commissioners. I remember I went up there and I told the father, I said, the commissioners are here. He said, well, not to be disrespectful, you're not going to speak. And the truth is, I didn't want to speak. What I wanted to do is I wanted to feel and I wanted to hear what the citizens of this county had to say. And that was the most powerful thing. Kelsey Bush did an excellent job. The speakers, all of them, did an excellent job. The key here is there is no KKK. There is one, but there is no room for one. We will not tolerate anything that puts people in an uncomfortable spot. We will not put up with this. We'll stamp it out as soon as we see it. And what I really felt good about that night was the community coming together and healing, if that's even a term. I know it's a term, but the point was we got a chance to hold candles, we got a chance to sing songs, we got a chance to listen to people with inspirational speeches. It was a moment of healing for this community, because we cannot in no way, shape, or form allow anything like this to happen in our county. Thank you.
Just add, during my invocation today, I alluded to this, but keep in mind that hate is an internal thing. It's not something that you can put soldiers out to fight against. It's not something you can put your police out to fight against. I mean, they can fight against the results of hate, of what happens when people embrace hate. So this is a battle that everybody can fight. Everybody. It doesn't matter if you're elderly, a little child. You need to keep love and peace in your heart. And when you push that out, you open the door for evil. And that's where this hate comes from. And so, yeah, it's probably a good reason they said, yeah, commissioners don't need to speak on this, because it isn't something you can delegate away. This is something that we have to accept that we want to be a better persons, we want to be a better people. And therefore, as St. Francis says, let's all be channels for peace and push this hate out of our community. Thank you.
I want to echo the thoughts of the fellow commissioners. We don't have room for hate. We don't want to be, we're not tolerant of hate. I think love and peace. I always give the peace sign every day for the last 8 years, and I'll be doing it for four more, because it's about peace and not in harmony and not hate. So I echo my fellow commissioners' thoughts.
In real brief, I like to talk about internally, but at least my experience in the military, to talk about getting together, working together, regardless of what your status may be in life is. Our first day of basic training, now of course this is a long time ago, back in 1966, when I went into the Air Force in January, but this four-stripe sergeant, he was a staff sergeant, was here. We're all standing in front of the barracks, about 100 of us, and he was walking down with his clipboard, and he said, "To me, you're nothing but a number. That's all you are. You are just a number. Don't forget your number. That's important for you the rest of your life in the service now and forever, but just remember you're a number." And I thought, my God, they've just really cut me down from, I thought, a good civilized person down to a number. But what I realized was that working with everybody else, regardless of who you may be, we depended on each other to make it through the military. It became very important in Vietnam when I was there. I didn't care what color you were, what your religion was, or anything. I hoped you could do your job because it could have meant saving my life and your life. And that became very important. We do need to get together and realize that life can be a lot easier if we get hate inside of us. Just get it out. Let's function, do our job, provide the services we all need, and that's what we do as our county, provide great services so that your life can go on. But we've got to get this hate, and it's got to go away. I have a first and a second. All those agree?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have.
Thank you, commissioners. And item C is from the Office of the Circuit Court to present the subrecipient agreement with One Step at a Time, LLC, under Project MD-1925. Pete Cucinato, coordinator of the Drug Court Program, presenting this morning. Good morning.
How are you
doing?
We've
got a subrecipient with a new vendor we have in the county that just came online and got state approval to bring sober house services to women. It's a 5-bed facility off of Great Mills Road, and the subrecipient will allow us to utilize their services for the women that may need it that come through the adult recovery court.
I support this, but tell me, how many people are we talking about?
Well, they have a 5-bed facility, which is open to anybody. So I don't know how many exactly we'll use throughout the year. That fluctuates, Commissioner, from our needs.
Okay, but maximum 5 people can stay there?
Correct. That's all it's approved for, yes.
Okay.
They went through a year process with the state to get it approved.
Okay.
And actually started with one of our graduates.
Where's it located?
Behind the car wash, a block off Great Mills Road. I don't know exactly.
Down.
I've visited and toured it.
Saratoga?
Sounds like it.
I believe so, yes. Yeah. The first block up on the right corner there.
I move to approve and authorize Commissioner President to execute the subrecipient agreement between the Commissioners of St. Mary's County and One Step at a Time, LLC, for sober housing services in the amount of $6,000.
Second.
I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any disapproval? Ayes have it.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Thank you.
Thanks, Dr.
Thank you, Commissioners. And item D is from the Sheriff's Office to present the application for state aid for police protection, FY 2020. And Sheriff Cameron or Major American, Lottie Bell, fiscal manager, come into the table. Good morning, Lottie. How are you?
Good morning. Good.
Hello, Ms. Bell.
Good morning.
Welcome.
So this morning we are requesting your permission to apply online for the State Aid Police Protection Funding for FY 2020.
It's busy.
There are actually 3 components. There's Form 2, which is the estimated expenditures for police protection in FY 19. Form 3, which relates to the number of police officers we have, and Form 1 is for the actual FY 2018 expenditures, and that will be presented to you in January 2019 when we have more firm numbers.
It's a pretty good grant, $944,000.
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. So that'll go for deputies or what?
It just supplements the police, the cost of police protection in the county.
So who wrote the grant application?
It's a collaborative effort.
I always say this, because I just want people to understand, it's about $1 million.
Yeah.
And it is not easy to write a grant application, it's hard. So it's for every, for folks on your team who wrote that, congratulations, that's great. You've saved the taxpayers a lot of money.
I agree.
It's a collaborative effort, and we have to get a lot of information from other county departments, and they're very responsive and helpful, and we really appreciate them working with us to accomplish it, because it's a very quick turnaround time on the grant as well.
Grants are good.
Very good.
I move to approve the grant application for fiscal year 2020 State Aid for Police Protection, SAPP, from the Governor's Office of Crime Control and Prevention, and authorize the Sheriff's Office to submit the application electronically consistent with the documents reviewed by the Commissioners of St. Mary's County, and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents subsequent to the electronic filing.
Second.
I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you, Commissioners. And the next item is also from the Sheriff's Office, with the award of the FY18 Edward Byrne Memorial Justice Assistance Grant Program, the local solicitation. Ms. Bell continues to present.
Okay.
And you're joined at the table by Lieutenant Russell and Captain Sweeney. Am I right?
Yes.
Thank you.
We're both. Okay.
Good morning.
Morning.
So next we have an award of the FY18 Edward Byrne Memorial Justice Assistance Grant Program, local solicitation. The related application was presented to you on August 21st of 2018. And at that time we said that additional county funding would be needed to fully fund the piece of equipment to be purchased. And today we're requesting your approval of the documents, the award documents, and a budget amendment to use local asset forfeiture money to cover the remaining funds needed for the equipment. Captain Sweeney or Lieutenant Russell are here to answer any specific questions you may have.
Tell me about your asset forfeiture fund. Is that obviously be a fluctuating fund, I would assume?
Yes.
And
there's no restrictions on our local asset forfeiture funding.
I mean, is it like $1 million or $10,000?
Our estimate, the rolling balance is about $183,460.
Well, Mr. President, I move to approve the fiscal year 18 Edward Byrne Memorial Justice Assistance Grant JAG program solicitation award documents project US 1936 from the US Department of Justice for the amount of $18,858 for the purchase of equipment.
Second.
I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Motion number two, I move to approve the related budget amendment that includes realigning asset forfeiture funding to cover the $10,897 additional county funding needed and the $566 to be set aside to cover the total cost of the equipment, and the set aside requirement authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents and Sheriff's Office staff to submit electronically.
Second.
I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Item F is from the Department of Economic Development with the establishment of Tourism Regulatory Task Force. Chris Casalimas, Director, Economic Development, presenting this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning, Commissioners. Today we're asking Commissioners to approve the formation of a task force to review county regulations related to tourism, the tourism economy. The group will work toward refining the regulations so that tourism industry can thrive while keeping in mind the health, welfare, and safety of the county residents. The Tourism and Hospitality Master Plan was approved by Commissioners in March of 2017, and that included a recommendation to review regulatory issues that are impacting tourism. We have had several informal meetings with external parties to review some regulations, but today we're asking Commissioners to formally approve a task force. There are two immediate issues that the task force will tackle. The first is the number of events that can be held per year on agriculturally zoned property. The current limit is 20. The second is the regulation associated with parking a recreational vehicle on a property that can be used for vacation rentals. It's important when reviewing these regulations to take into account the impact on adjacent property owners. For example, when weddings are held on farms, neighbors can be affected by noise and traffic. So the task force will look to strike a balance between what's reasonable, given that nearby residents may be affected. task force includes a mix of internal staff members and also external people that can bring their perspective. The suggested members are Mary Wood from Forest Hall Farm, who has a thriving ag tourism business, Jason All, who is our new tourism director for Visit St. Mary's MD, Jim Grube from Woodlawn and Jubilee Farm, Steve Wall, who's a resident living across from Jubilee Farm, across the water there. He's also the Department of Commerce representative, but he's going to be acting as a, he's going to be acting as a private citizen. Phil Langley, who's on our Economic Development Commission. He's also on our Ag and Seafood Commission, and he runs Fish the Bay Charters and also has a rental on his property. And then Bill Hunt, and I will also be on the committee and some of our staff members. So related to the formation of this group is an existing group that was established by our Ag and Seafood Commission called the Agricultural Use Work Group. And this group is reviewing all county regulations related to agriculture industry and developing recommendations. Any of their recommendations that relate to tourism will be provided to the Tourism Task Force for their review. So with that,
it's a good group. I mean, I like the people that you have on this. Because the idea is, you said it perfectly, strike the balance.
Yeah.
And that's the issue. I mean, when we're changing from an agricultural society and we're moving into, you know, a different type of environment, and we're trying to keep the farms
agritourism,
you know, and get the agritourism up, they have to understand that it still has impact on their neighbors. Yeah. So it's interesting, the two gentlemen that you have on here, because of course, you know, I won't put names, but one is, his job is about economic development growth in the state, and at the same time he's aggravated a bit as a citizen who lives in the community. So I think this is a really good group of people, and I'll be interested to hear what you guys come up with.
Thank you.
From the outside, not from here.
Read the paper, right?
That's right.
Well, I move to establish a tourism regulatory task force as outlined in the subject material.
Second.
I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioners. And item G is from the Department of Aging and Human Services to introduce the senior care grant application for FY19. Lori Jennings Harris, Director, Rebecca Kessler, Manager, and Angie Graves, Fiscal Supervisor, all from the Department of Aging and Human Services. Good morning, ladies.
Good morning, ladies.
Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you, Dr. Bridget. So as just mentioned, this is the FY19 Senior Care Grant Application. Our department has coordinated this program for well over 20 years. It's a gap-filling program which provides services and goods to individuals age 65 and older. We do things like provide personal care, assistance with medications, home chore, et cetera. So the grant from the Maryland Department of Aging is in the amount of $112,821 for a total budget of $122,618, which includes the county's match.
And grants are good.
Yeah, no department writes more grants than yours. I know that.
Thank you.
I move to approve the senior care grant application project number MD1903 from Maryland Department of Aging on behalf of St. Mary's County Department of Aging and Human Services in the amount of $122,618 for the purpose of implementing the senior care program in St. Mary's County, and authorize the Commissioner President to execute the related documents.
Second.
I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Thank you, Commissioners. And item H is from the Department of Human Resources with the St. Mary's County Government Manual of Personnel Policies and Procedures Proposed Revisions. Catherine Pratson, Director, presenting this morning. Good morning again.
Good morning. Hello again, Commissioners. Annually, the County Government Manual of Personnel Policies and Procedures is reviewed and updates are proposed as necessary. The current personnel manual was approved by the commissioners in October of 2017, and in April of 2018, an update to all sick leave references occurred as a result of Maryland's sick and safe leave legislation. Many of the updates being presented today are non-substantial, are policy clarifications, or are updates based upon current practices. The commissioners have been provided with redlined versions of the proposed policy changes. And as an example of some of the policy changes that are included, one, for example, is in Chapter 6, clarifying personal information that will or will not be released for both employees and volunteers or interns. Another proposed example, a proposed policy change, is references to emergency services and technology throughout the manual has been updated to reflect that their two departments now exist. Mm-hmm. As recently proposed and approved in the hourly manual, a prohibition against workplace bullying is proposed, and that policy is identical to the one the commissioners approved for the hourly manual. A further clarification to meal reimbursement when employees are traveling one day has been included. In the employee donated leave program, a clarification that compensatory time can be donated is included, and a clarification of how employee retirements can be recognized by the commissioners has been included. More substantive policy changes that are proposed include an update to the emergency closing policy. We spent quite a bit of time looking at that and have developed protocol, and there are examples when the county can close for an emergency, but it's not a declared emergency. Those are two different things, and that clarification has been included in the manual. As previously mentioned, sick and safe leave references have been changed and updated, and a new proposal is to allow individuals who are transferring from another agency or who are coming to work for St. Mary's County government could transfer a balance of their sick leave with them. We feel that that will help our recruiting be more competitive. That is something that neighboring agencies provide.
I'm just curious, do the other counties nearby do the same type of thing?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, that's something we should advertise a little bit. Because you could pull federal civil servants away from their job to come over to county if they knew about this.
And other state agencies and other county governments, and we have lost some employees this year, and one of the reasons in the exit interview was they said that they could bring their sick leave with them, that was made the move enticing for them.
Yeah.
So we feel that that will help us be competitive. And then a clarification to suspensions and employee suspensions has been added. Additional policy changes will be presented in an upcoming meeting to include updates to the employee substance abuse policy, updates to the employee grievance policy, and a proposed student loan reimbursement policy. So this briefing today is to discuss the proposed changes and to find out if the commissioners have any policies that they wish to be reviewed or any comments before we move forward.
I have two questions, please. Section 1812, the manual provides for promotional increases of more than 10% only with the approval of the commissioners. The language delegate this approval to the county administrator. Why would you do that?
We had a couple of examples this past year when the circuit court, the sheriff requested that, and we brought that forward to the commissioners and understood that everybody felt that it wasn't necessary to bring it forward to the commissioners, that it was easily agreed to. So this was a proposed.
But those were circuit court, right? What about individual employees within the departments?
We've not had those requests. So it was the sheriff's office we brought forward and the circuit court we brought forward.
But it does then, with that change, it does open it up to all the employees of the county?
Currently, yes. And certainly that could be changed if you wanted.
Okay. It does, but 10% of anybody's salary in St. Mary's County government is not a huge amount of money.
That's true.
I would say keep it at the county administrator level just because you're going to get a whole bunch of requests brought into the commissioners where they can be handled locally, tactfully, I think.
I agree. You can have to say a small amount. Yeah.
Okay. Would this include directors?
No.
Yeah, it would not. No.
The second question is on Section 2205. The proposed language provides that the timing of an employee's compressed work schedule day off may be modified by the finance department because of a holiday. Do we have varying compressed work schedules for the employees?
It's typically a Friday or a Monday. And currently the practice is if your compressed work schedule is a Friday, and this Thanksgiving was an example, mm-hmm. and Friday is a holiday, we ask that you take it on Wednesday before the holiday. But there will be an occasion when that is a different pay period. So finance may have to override that and have you take it on the Monday. And this just allows that opportunity or notifies employees that under certain circumstances, finances may not allow you to take the day you want because of how the pay periods are falling.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
Dr. Bridget, does Commissioner-elect Colvin have a copy of this, since they're going to vote on it next month?
He will have a copy. It's just a briefing.
Okay, thanks.
Any other questions, Commissioners?
Okay, thank you. And we will come forward with the other proposed changes.
Okay, thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Catherine. And item I is from the Department of Human Resources to present the resolution for 2018 holiday leave. Ms. Pratson continues to present.
Yes, thank you. And this morning I'm presenting a request for the commissioners to consider providing county employees with additional paid leave during the upcoming Christmas holiday. During past Christmas seasons, you've generously provided additional paid leave in recognition of county employees and of their work throughout the year. This year, our neighboring counties have elected to close on December 24th and on December 31st to provide their employees with additional holiday leave. The request before you is to do the same, to provide December 24th and the 31st of December as additional days of holiday leave, and to provide floating holiday leave hours for those who are required to work during that time. And thank you in advance for your consideration.
Has our neighboring counties already done this?
Charles and Calvert, yes.
Have already done it?
Yes.
Thank you.
What about state and federal? Are they working?
I'm not sure.
Well, thank you for giving me the opportunity to make this motion, because on my last day, I move to approve the 2018 resolution for additional holiday leave, providing St. Mary's County employees with December 24th and December 31st, 2018, as additional paid holiday leave or as a floating holiday leave for employees required to work on those dates.
Second.
I have a first and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you, Commissioners.
Thank you, Commissioners. And item J is from the Office of the County Attorney to review the county-owned surplus real property. David Weiskopf, Acting County Attorney, and Brandy McKelvey, paralegal, presenting this morning.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Commissioners, as you know, we were here back in August to discuss the 100, I believe actually it was about 125 properties initially, and then about 27 of them were held back by different county agencies that thought that they might have some use for them. So we came to you with roughly 104 to ask you what to do with these properties that the county had ended up owning after the tax sales, because nobody else bid on them. And you gave us direction to move forward and try to get them back into the hands of citizens and back on the tax rolls. And we have currently sold 13 of the 104, have three pending, but we've received approximately 57 applications. Obviously, some were for the same piece of property. Some were for a lower amount, but we haven't gone there yet. And some are still doing their due diligence and attempting to figure out if the property is worth anything, or they can do what they want to do on that property. So we're just really here to update you on that. And we were also given direction to move forward with speaking with the homeowners associations of Longview Beach and Mill Point Shores. And I know one of them is going to put the list in their annual bills that go out in January, and that's Longview Beach.
Yes.
Is going to do that. So both of the HOAs and their members are aware of it. But to also give you the bottom line, for the 13 finalized transactions, we've collected $26,209.87, and the total to be collected on the three pending transactions is $4,242.49, for a grand total of $30,452.36.
So progress.
Progress. That's
definitely.
That's where we are.
I think it puts them back on the tax rolls.
Certainly. Mm-hmm. Certainly.
Yeah, I think that's the most important part of this, is that the people listening in don't think, oh, wow, you sold 13 properties for $30,000. That's not the point. We put them back on the tax rolls. That's progress. That's great.
And these are all unimproved properties that you may or may not be able to do anything with, number one. And so I think what we'd like to do is come back in 3 months and let you know how it's gone and if we've kind of plateaued, maybe give you some other suggestions about ways that we could, you know, try to get rid of the rest, I guess. If that makes sense.
That's good. Do we have any way of providing these to nonprofit organizations? Or is there any vehicle? I was approached by the commander of the Disabled American Veterans. They're looking for a home place. And they asked me if we had any properties available that they could get somehow, either free or at a low cost, so they could establish a home for themselves.
Okay, well, we can take a look at what we have.
Okay.
And see.
They were looking for properties in the right. California, Hollywood area, something that.
If you recall, the properties that we currently have available for sale on the are ones that people have already picked over through the since we've had them, because everybody's always been allowed to come to our office before we've gotten the final order and purchased a tax sale certificate from us. So we have had groups of individuals pick through them once already. Okay. Now that they've been out in the public, they've been picked through again. So we're kind of at the bottom of you know, probably buildable houses, you know, exactly. Buildable lots.
Buildable you're lots. Dealing with lots that you can't.
Yeah, we need a buildable lots.
But we will certainly take a look. And
I'd appreciate it. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
Anything else, commissioners? Thanks for the effort. This is looking good.
It's all staff. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, commissioners. And item K is from the Department of Public Works and Transportation for the FDR Boulevard Phase 1B and part of C, First Colony Boulevard to Old Rolling Road, to present traffic ordinances and resolutions. John Diedrich, Director, and Alan Settle, Engineer 2, presenting this morning. Good morning.
Good morning. Thank you very much.
Good morning, John. Alan. Morning. Glad to see you all here.
All right. Attached in your packet is, of course, the usual memo that explains why we're here and what we'd like to do. A number of ordinances and one resolution and a PowerPoint. So I'll go through a summary of the material, and then Alan and I will go through the PowerPoint. So on November 28th, 2017, construction of Phase 1B of FDR Boulevard from First Colony to 225 feet west of Old Rolling Road was considered substantially complete. There's still some work going on there, converting that from the way the road was to FDR standards, but it's substantially complete and being used by the motoring public. Another section of the road work, Phase 1C, building the roadway another section of the roadway work, Phase 1C, building the roadway 525 feet west of Old Rolling Road to the roundabout intersection at Old Rolling Road provides a connection to Phase 1B and is also at the point of being considered substantially complete. This two-lane road is 0.72 miles in length and was constructed as a complete street in order to give all users of the roadway safe passage, pedestrians, bicyclists, and motorists, with a raised median, a single lane in each direction, with an additional right turn lane northbound at First Colony Boulevard intersection, bike lanes, sidewalks, and a roundabout intersection, landscaping, and streetlights. So what you have attached as a result of this work being done is four motions and three ordinances, one resolution. The ordinances cover traffic control. The resolution accepts those sections of the roadway into the county maintenance system.
Let's get it done. We need to open that road up.
Right.
Motion one, I move to adopt the resolution accepting FDR Boulevard from First Colony Boulevard to Old Rolling Road into the county highway maintenance system.
Second. I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Motion two, I move to adopt the ordinance setting a maximum speed and establishing a stop intersection at FDR Boulevard and establishing a yield intersection on all approaches of the FDR Boulevard and Old Rolling Road intersection.
Second.
Discussion. I see you want to put 35 mile an hour on this thing.
Yes.
What's the minimum the county requires? 25?
What's 25 for subdivision type streets. For this type of roadway, an arterial type roadway, it's recommended either between 30 or 35 mile per hour. This roadway is designed with a minimum 45 mile per hour design. So we have that 10 mile per hour difference, but with the bike lanes and all along the side of the road, the 35 mile per hour is adequate for this roadway. We don't want vehicles flying down this roadway either, because there's going to be pedestrians on the sidewalks, people riding their bikes on the bike lanes. So 35 miles per hour, mile per hour maximum speed for this road, we believe, is appropriate. The current posted speed limit out there in the First Colony section is 35 miles per hour. So it will just continue all the way to the old Rolling Road roundabout, the 35 miles per hour. Now, once we get to the old Rolling Road roundabout, we then start getting into heavy residential areas.
And
that will be decreased to 30 miles per hour. Right. So
I just thought 35 was too fast going, especially when you're dealing with a roundabout.
Well, when you approach that roundabout, you're going to start to see warning signs popping up. You'll see this roundabout coming. And 35 miles per hour coming into a roundabout is adequate. And
did you ever look into the lights from the section Route 4 to where this 1B or whatever starts?
The lights, they've been recently shut off for some reason, the decorative street lights. We have been in contact with SMECO and also the Development Corporation as well. They're now investigating. They're trying to figure out what caused the outage on these street lights out there right now. They should have it fixed very soon, though. So.
Okay, so it's in the works.
It's in the works.
Probably
yes.
When they fixed Harris Theaters, the road in front of Harris Theater.
Al, let me ask you two questions. A stop intersection on FDR Boulevard, will that be at First Colony and FDR?
That is, if you know where the Columbia Colony housing development is for the Navy housing, there's a small street that enters onto FDR Boulevard.
And it
used to be a T turnaround before FDR was built. That will be the stop intersection at Clark Drive on the FDR Boulevard.
If you're going down, I drove the road the other day because the barrier was open, so you can't get down there.
So you're talking about the new section.
The new section. So when you get to that circled old rolling road, you will slow down just because the way that circle works itself, whether you're coming on old rolling road or FDR, you're not going to be able to go fast through there whatsoever.
No, I agree with you, but I didn't want people going fast through there and then finding out they can't go that fast.
We usually have a sign. It'll show the circle.
Oh, yeah.
20 miles an hour on it.
We've got the roundabout signs up with old rolling road.
It'll designate 20 in most of them I've seen.
Yeah, there's warning signs posted.
Will it be designated 20 or 25?
Speed limit, we don't have a speed limit sign on that roundabout sign. It's not required per the MUTCD. But with the slower speed limit.
When it comes, they have a 20 mile an hour speed limit on.
Yeah, a lot of them you will see with the posted speed limit, but the lower speeds, now keep in mind these roads are 50 mile per hour roads coming up to a roundabout, but for the lower speeds of either 30 or 35 miles per hour, we're not putting up that warning sign because you can see this roundabout right in front of you with all the warning signs and yield signs and everything else.
The truck that went through Clemens must not have seen none of those signs.
Yeah, well, I'm not sure what happened there.
I guess my question was, will there be any stop signs on this road?
The question is, where's the stop? My concern becomes this.
Yes.
Is that the FDR Boulevard is being constructed now from Sanders Church Road down to the circle will be straight through. There'll be no stop signs along the way.
Correct.
So the big thing for the public to understand is that for years you've been able to go down First Colony Boulevard, make that right with a slowing down rather than stopping. And now that stop sign is going to be there and have significance because traffic is becoming from their left into that intersection.
Well,
so I think part of there's going to be a lot of education on this one. Trust me, the way that people drive back there. Then I think the sheriff and Captain Hall back there are going to sit there and nod their head. It might be a good idea to get there and have some traffic enforcement, guys.
At that intersection, at First Colony Boulevard, there are existing stop signs there. There are two, one on each lane. When you're coming east on First Colony Boulevard.
As you're approaching the FDR Boulevard, you're correct.
So those will remain, and those were already approved under a prior resolution to ordinance.
I get that.
Yeah, but those will remain.
I get that part, because the person who's going to make that left.
Turning on to First Colony.
Turning on to First, has to remember that that traffic is coming at them. And the people who make the rolling stop sign, because there's never anything on the left before, are going to have to start paying a lot of attention to that. So we're going to, you know, open this thing on December the 11th or whatever the magical date is. But, you know, as people ease into this, understand there's going to be a lot of understanding to take place about how this new road is going to work.
Yes, and we're trying to.
I'm sorry to be so thick, but just tell me. Yes. You're going to be able to drive from St. Andrew Church Road all the way, when this is done, Chancellor's Run Road, without a stop sign. Only thing you'll have is roundabouts.
That is correct.
Okay.
That is correct. When FDR1 is completely finished.
There's not going to be any stop signs or traffic lights on FDR Boulevard.
There won't be any stopping on FDR Boulevard. There'll be yield signs at the roundabouts.
And in the roundabouts. Right.
Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Good. Then I'm ready to vote.
Any other questions, commissioners?
No, sweet.
Okay, we have a first and a second on motion two. All's in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Motion three, I move to adopt the ordinance designating the shoulders of FDR Boulevard as bicycle lanes.
Second.
Have first, second, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Motion four, I move to adopt the ordinance designating the lane usage on southbound and northbound FDR Boulevard at the First Colony Boulevard intersection.
Second.
Have a first and second, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
And what is the hang up on this section? It didn't look like it was that big a deal. It seemed like the roundabout would have been the bigger deal. But between there and Amber Drive or whatever that's called.
Yes. First, when the project first started last year, we had to do several utility relocations. One was a gas relocation down where the stream crossing was located between Laurel Glen and Hickory Hills. That gas relocation took 3 months longer than planned. But then what we also found, as the contractor was working on the existing FDR piece in the Laurel Glen section, SMECO and the contractor realized that instead of having one primary electric line to the Beverly Hills subdivision, there were actually two primary electric lines on the one side of the road. Those all had to be relocated. The trouble was we didn't have enough room to relocate two primary lines. So what we had to do was switch the primary lines to the opposite side of the road. This required directional drilling by SMECO and their contractors. This took approximately 3 months to do. Our contractor could not work on the inlets and the one side of FDR through the existing section of FDR Boulevard. So we had some utility issues along the way that kind of pushed things back a little bit. And then the other issue, which I'm sure you're aware of, is since June 5th, we've had 40 inches of rain, which is just
amazing.
Astonishing to me. And I've never seen this before, you know, as long as I've been a project manager. But the rain, and it comes every 3 days, every 4 days, saturates the site. Just like this weekend, we had close to 3 inches of rain on Saturday, more than what we thought was going to happen. And then actually yesterday morning, we thought there was going to be a light sprinkle. We had a half inch of rain yesterday morning. So that has kind of pushed our paving back a little bit. We're trying to dry out the site so that we can get the final hot mix asphalt down. And once we do that, we can then get the line striping down and then open up the road as a soft opening to get traffic flowing to the old rolling road roundabout. But we still have work to do to try to in that triple culvert crossing. And John, up on the screen, what you'll see is the location of the triple culverts. The contractor has it all set up and planned, ready to go. What you can barely see on this photo is a stream crossing, a stream diversion. There's actually a large 48-inch pipe that's buried underneath this that has actually shifted the stream away from where our triple culverts are going to go. So this is the next round of work that has to take place and to get those culverts installed and and also get the surcharge placed on top of the embankment to allow for settlement. There's very poor soil conditions in this location, so we need everything to settle equally in this location. So that is why this section connecting over to Phase 1A will not be completed until the spring of 2019.
One quick observation. They said on the news last night we've got 24 inches over what we normally get for this time of year. Mm-hmm. Last question is, when are them barrels are going to be out of the way at the Harris Teeter? I mean, they paved it. They got it all done. When are you going to open that thing up?
Yeah, I sent out another email, and I haven't received a response to it yet.
I mean, they paved it, and they leave the cones out there.
Right. I think there's a lot more to that than we know, from what I understand.
Well, let's find out, because everybody asked me, Mike, what's going on?
I know. And also the issue at what's going on at Airport Road and 235 as well.
That's another mess. It's taking
Let's remember that I agree with you, the FDR piece is the cones, but the whole St. Andrews Church Road and the Airport Drive, that's another mess with the state. And as much as John and me yell and complain, it goes in one ear and out the other. But I will say, I like this picture because I can actually see the light at the end of the tunnel. I can see this road here. I can see this little pile of dirt that's taken us 3 years to get over, and I can see a road at the other end.
So you're saying no soft opening by the 30th then?
We'll see.
We're trying to have it open by the end of this week, but most likely will be the mid-week next week. If we can keep the rain away.
When it's ready. I mean,
that's what we're trying. That is exactly what we're trying to do. But we're also pushing the contractor.
8 years for 3/4 of a mile. A week isn't going to make a damn difference anymore.
we're working hard to try and get this open. Yeah.
Very good. Well, I understand. I think this morning they said another inch and a half of rain. We will set a all-time record for rainfall in this area. Mm-hmm. Another inch and a half by the end of the year. That's all we need. And we set an all-time record.
Yeah.
Well, I understand. When you're working outside like that, roads and whatever, very difficult.
Yeah.
Thank you for all the hard work.
Thanks.
Yeah, Alan, there's also the temperature issue, too, isn't there, with the asphalt?
Yeah, that's going to be the next thing.
The temperature issue, we're trying to deal with that.
Yeah, you got to be with like 50 degrees or higher or something
We really want to be 45 degrees and above. However, the specifications will allow for 40 degrees and above as long as the surface temperature is 40 degrees and the ambient air temperature is 40 degrees, we can install the asphalt. We would prefer 45 degrees. It's a better product in the end.
I understand.
But we need to try and get this road open. Remember, the contractor's under warranty as well. So they're paying close attention to these temperatures as well.
And this week's not looking good.
This week's going to be tough. They have to, most likely they'll be paving in the mid-morning and afternoon when the temperatures get up a little higher.
Right.
So that's the plan.
Yep. Weekend looks good.
Yep.
Any other questions, Commissioner?
Thank you
all very much.
Appreciate it. Thank you, John and Alan.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Item L is from the Department of Land Use and Growth Management to provide a briefing on amending the comprehensive zoning ordinance. Bill Hunt, Director, presenting this morning.
Good morning.
Mr. Hunt, how you doing?
Fine, thank you.
Good.
Okay. Thank you, Commissioner. Sorry for the delay there. If I may, I'll present from here in case I need to point out something to the cursor.
Yes, sir. Fine. That's fine.
Today is a briefing on why the current zoning ordinance needs to be amended and some recommendations as to how this can be accomplished. The current zoning ordinance was adopted in 2010. It's 400 pages long. It's been amended 11 times in parts between its effective date and today. Here's a shot of the cover that shows where the amendments were, the dates. So what amendments are needed? I've made a list of some of the more important ones that we're aware of in the office, beginning with the need to adopt the text, to amend the text to comply with the zoning amendments that are going to be necessary to implement the Lexington Park Development District Master Plan. These include the amendments to Articles 3, 4, 5, and 6, as you see there. You're well aware of the commercial dock use ordinance that's been proposed. We would like to amend the ordinance to comply with federal requirements regarding cell towers and the technology changes that have taken place. The requirement for traffic impact studies and the timing of completion of improvements was something that was just mentioned with respect to St. Mary's Marketplace, the Harris Teeter project. It needs to be revised to support the Department of Economic Development's tourism plan and to modify ag uses. There's recently been a series of meetings with the Ag and Forestry Board with they put forward some draft recommendations for amendments that should be incorporated in the ordinance in a comprehensive manner. You've heard from the Navy about the desire and the need for an ACUS along Webster Field. There are specifications in the current zoning ordinance that differentiate between minor and major site plans that sometimes come into conflict with one another that need to be straightened out.
I would agree with you on that. I've gotten many calls on why major site plans are needed for small things, and it's driving the cost and it's keeping people from doing stuff.
Exactly. It's a provision in the ordinance that defines those two criteria for the types of site plans that are allowed. And until they get changed in the ordinance, my office follows what's written there, because it is written clearly. It's not written pragmatically, practically, but it's been that way, as we say in St. Mary's County. It's pragmatic. Time to change those things.
Pragmatic is a good term to use.
Well, it when we get to the idea of stakeholders, that's what we need to do, is have something that meets everybody's needs to the extent possible. You can't satisfy everybody, but the developers, engineers, owners, commissioners, everybody who has a stake in a zoning ordinance that's practical and pragmatic for everybody, I hope will come to the table if this is approved, and we can get their inputs and sort them out and bring them to the commissioners for policy decisions. This undeveloped open space requirement that's in the ordinance doesn't make any sense and can't be implemented, but it's there. Public and private road threshold is there, and they contradict one another. The buffer provisions, if you follow what goes before the Board of Appeals, many times it's a request to reduce a buffer width, particularly a width from 65 to 30 or less. No one has 65 feet of land in the development district that they can put for a buffer. It's just not reasonable. So they go to the Board of Appeals for variance, and it's usually granted, but you've got that public hearing process and the expense. It's time to review that provision and find out what is necessary for a buffer ordinance. There are 129 uses in the zoning ordinance. Some of the terms that define them aren't reasonable, they don't make sense and contradict one another, so that needs to be looked at, and that's a major task in and of itself. Every now and then we hear of a request for a solar farm. Solar farm is not in the zoning ordinance at all. Needs to have some provision made in it. The sign focus group has recently completed its draft sign ordinance, and that will be coming to legal for review to be sure that it complies with federal law shortly, at which point it'll be incorporated into the zoning ordinance. There is a noise ordinance currently in the zoning ordinance. However, one county attorney has told us that it's really not appropriate because it goes beyond what the state allows the county to do. The state sets some requirements and some thresholds, and the county ordinance doesn't comply with those. Transfer development rights programs in the zoning ordinance, it needs to be looked at. To see if it can be simplified, to see how well it's working. Non-conforming uses and structures is an oddity in the zoning ordinance because it allows a certain amount of expansion of non-conforming uses, whereas the overall intent of a non-conforming provision is an ordinance to actually try to phase things out. So the idea that we allow them to expand while we're still trying to get rid of them is a contradiction in and of itself, which causes confusion from time to time. Then all of these things are small in and of themselves, but you need to coordinate all of this and also be sure that what you've got when you're done is consistent with the comprehensive plan, because in Maryland, of course, the comprehensive plan is a guiding document that has to be followed, and your zoning ordinance is intended to implement the comprehensive plan in part. So obviously you don't want contradictions between your comprehensive plan or your sub-area plans and your zoning ordinance. The livability code isn't in the zoning ordinance, but it's a separate document that hasn't been looked at in quite some time, and we think that it, in the process of doing this, that it would be time to look at that. I mentioned stakeholders, residents, surveyors, engineers, developers, property owners. The commissioners may want to form a focus group like was done for the sign ordinance. And also, you may recall that there was what I call the shed focus group when the request before the commissioners was to expand the residential accessory structures to allow 600-foot shed to be built without the requirement for building inspections. There was one meeting of that group, and they got it done in that one meeting, and we proposed that amendment, which was accepted. There will have to be a large number of public meetings for this. The sign focus group met 14 times to discuss that. This all goes into a transparent public participation process. As I said in my cover memo, a lot of times this kind of major project will be done with a consultant. It's a little impractical, I think, because of the need to involve the public. You pay a lot of windshield time for a consultant to have to come to a lot of public meetings, and yet you have to have a lot of public meetings because sign focus group, the meetings were an hour to an hour and a half, and really when you're asking people to come in after a day of work and stay from 6 to 7:30 twice a month, it gets old after a while. So a consultant would never be able to handle a schedule like that, I don't think. And yet, if you want continuity with public participation, you're going to have these numerous public meetings when it's convenient to have people attend. So the overall recommendation for how I think St. Mary's County can approach this in a practical way is we recently had the retirement of the planner for the zoning administration position. It's currently described in such a manner that it has more duties than would be involved with this major task. But if the department could redefine that position and then re-advertise it in such that that position would be primarily the project manager for this and not have staff supervision responsibilities so that the entire time could be devoted to this, I think it would be a good way to accomplish this with the minimum amount of time, though it's going to be very time consuming as it is. It won't require an adjustment in budget. It doesn't require the addition of an FTE. It's just redefining and filling a position that's open that we already have. Then I kind of rushed through this, but one of the things that Dr. Bridget wanted to put before you was at least put to you the list of known amendments and see if we get any recommendations for prioritization either at this meeting or some subsequent meeting to know what we can do, what we can move forward with. As I've mentioned, we are moving forward with the Lexington Park Development District Master Plan, both the zoning maps and the text amendments that are necessary. The signed ordinance will go to legal for review. We've got the critical area ordinance that's been approved. Well, the draft has been approved by critical area staff and our staff. It's just a matter of getting that formally accepted or recommended by the Critical Area Commission and comes back to you. So a number of things going on, a number of priorities that we're working through.
Okay, tell me, when do you think this sign ordinance is going to be ready for us to deal with?
I don't think Dave Weiskopf has had a chance to look at it thoroughly yet to see if it's something he thinks he can handle in-house or if he's going to need outside help with checking on the legality of the provisions that are in there. Because
are we talking January? Are we talking
No, we're not
March?
Talking January, I wouldn't think. I think March might be more realistic.
Yeah, this sign ordinance thing has dragged on for a long time. Personally, I'd say on this major minor site plan, that's been a big deal. You get people who get a piece of property cut out and they want to do something with it, minor, whatever it is, then they're facing these big bills. So part of it or at least Mike Hewitt would be that you can say this is a $3,000 fee
Like this guy wants to put this airfield out on his property in the RCA and out in the 7th. No big deal. He approached me and said, Mike, I paid him a fee, but nothing's happening. What I got to do? My point being is, let's look at what our actual costs are and charge those costs. But I think sometimes we come up with a high number and it scares these people off. So a guy can buy a plane, can afford whatever the cost is. But some of these other people, though, who are part of big family farms don't have a lot of money.
Yeah.
And they're running into these thousands of dollars for a major site plan. So again, I think we got to be realistic about what we expect our staff to do. If it's expensive, we got to get paid for it. But on the other hand, I'd like to come up with a better way to help people do what they want to do with their own property. And that's my input for today.
And that's felt and understood by the department, which is why with Dr. Bridget's guidance, we're bringing this forward now. These things have accumulated and have become a logjam for people, and yet the ordinance says something. We need to change it so that those people don't have to go through these unnecessary expenses if we can find a way to get through
well,
this.
Well, personally, I'm reluctant to do a consultant because now we stretch this thing out for a year, 18 months, and it takes way too long. Why don't we look at low-hanging fruit? I mean, you've got this job. You've been over there since previous guy retired, and I'm sure you've seen things that can consistently come up that give you headaches. Let's figure those things out.
Well, most of those are on the list.
Oh, yeah. Good.
I think the recommendation to have an in-house person handle it, to Commissioner Hewitt's point, is important. Right. Keep in mind that the airport, as an example, is growing huge, and we've taken the time and the resources to assign someone full-time manage the airport now, because that's an important part of our economy. But another really important part of our economy, especially for my district, is tourism, as is ag tourism and things. And to your point, Commissioner Hewitt, about major site improvement, if you want to put a tasting, and you know, I won't put names, but there's, and you know who they are. There's a lot of farms out there that have wine tasting, beer tasting, whiskey tasting, and they want to put a barn up so people can come out and taste it. And they're told, well, you have to put curb and asphalt all the way down the farm road because it's a major site improvement. That just totally obliviates what people would come there for. They're coming there because they want to go to something that's rustic. They want to go to something that's rural. It's a farm life community. And the way the law is written now, they have to turn it into a city before someone can come take a shot of whiskey, which is stupid. And everybody knows that. So I applaud you for bringing it forward. We need to change the ordinance to make it make sense. Another one I'd ask you to look at, which wasn't on your list, but it's something that has come up recently for me, and some issues of people trying to build out on piers. Apparently, Calvert and Charles County have waivers over the MDE requirements that restrict you from actually putting restaurants out on piers. And we used to have them all the time. That's why people would come across from Virginia to gamble back in the day. But now I think MDE has an ordinance that says they're not allowed to build restaurants and things as such out on piers. Well, they do in Calvert County. And I think everyone in here who is listening enjoys the fact you can go over to Solomon's Island and go eat out a restaurant that's out on a pier. St. Mary's County, we're still restricted from doing that. And Calvert and Charles apparently have given waivers. So what do we need to do that? Is that a local ordinance change? Does that have to be taken by our delegation to the state? I don't know. I just know that we're unique in their ability or inability to do that, and that's something I think you should look at as well. So to summarize, you know, this is a huge impact on our agritourism attempts for economic development and diversity. So I applaud you for bringing it forward, and I wish I'd be here to help you push some changes through, but I'm sure the rest of these guys will do. Thank you.
Talking about that restriction there, there's a restriction on covering slips right over top of the water.
I'm not familiar with all the MDE things.
Yeah, I'm familiar with the Critical Areas Commission.
Right, it's part of that, and I can't understand. I was just vacationing down Emerald, and this guy just built a 20x40 covering over a dual boat slip going out into Bogue Sound, and I had to go by and ask. I said, did you have a special permission to do this? He goes, no, they're all up and down the sound. No.
Well, Randy, you got to understand what we're generating, and I know this through the...
Yeah.
Is that it covers the grasses don't grow because the sunlight.
Right.
So that's the concept. And the bay is in such bad shape. It's been part of the initial.
But now we got grasses coming back in a lot of it now.
72 or 75 when the bay was an F and they were saying we need more grasses to grow. So that's why they eliminated boathouses, coverings at keep like.
Of course, the Baltimore City dumping millions of gallons of raw sewage.
Again, really, I'm not sure about all that, but I'm just not.
Well, I guarantee you the public would like the fact that in St. Mary's County, it'd be nice to go to a restaurant that was on a pier versus having to go to Calvert Charles all the time. My point is, they're on the Chesapeake Bay, too, and they're waiving it, and we're restricting our economic growth here. So this is something we should look at.
Couple things. I think it's important what Commissioner Hewitt brought about the sign focus group, because I was tracking that pretty closely. And while we have focus groups, I think many times when your sign focus groups were scheduled to meet, you act a quorum.
Yes, sir.
So when we talk about focus groups, it's wonderful, but when people don't show up, it doesn't do us much good. You suggested the modification of the planner form. How many vacancies do you have in your office now?
As far as the professional planners go, we have three.
Three vacancies?
Yes, sir.
So this would be basically one of the three?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm just thinking ahead to budget season, and you know, you're down three, we have growth taking place, do you need more people? Well, it's a rhetorical question for today. But going down the road, we have to start thinking with something like this as a full-time job, plus the workloads for not only your department, but the departments out there, what do we have to be thinking about down range? So like I said, I think that the idea of a focus group, while it sounds nice, but having to hire a consultant, we'd be better off prior to having a full-time employee doing this, and that's their sole function in life. And it's not going to be easy because, as you said, there's many stakeholders, all of whom have an agenda. So I think we have, this is room for a lot of discussion going later on.
Thank you.
But I think it's more about action and less about meeting.
Sure. Yes, sir, it is. But you'll recall, of course, when we don't have enough meetings, by the time it gets to the commissioners for final action, we might have an audience that feels like they weren't heard, and that postpones the final action.
Okay, I agree with that. We want everybody heard.
Yes, we do.
But we want to pick up the pace.
We do indeed.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm for as fast as we can go and as open as we can go.
Okay, good.
Agreed.
Great. Thank you, commissioners. And if there's nothing further, this concludes county administrator time. Thank you, Bill.
Thank you, Dr. Bigger. Okay, next we go right into commissioner's time. We do a little differently this time. I'm going to start with Commissioner Hewitt, then we'll go to Commissioner Morgan, and then myself, and we'll give Commissioner Jarboe the last call.
The last word.
Okay. Okay, Thanksgiving. Hey, great time, great family. I know the Hewitts had over 20 people over Thanksgiving. Good holiday. But I want to back up to the Unity Vigil. And how that was something that the community grabbed onto and wanted to have people come together and talk about this horrible thing that was going on in the county and how we had to stomp on it. And thank God we did. And I was glad I went and held my candle and sang my songs. But you know, it morphed into the holiday season. Again, Thanksgiving's a great time, and here's a tree lighting in Leonardtown with thousands of people packed in there. A little cold, but great time. And then I want to mention who I think is a really unique individual in St. Mary's County. His name's Joseph Knott, but he goes by Bubby. And what he has is, according to my grandchildren, Christmas Town, down on Flatiron Road and down there in Valley Lee, Great Mills, whatever that area is called. And the point is, we went there, and Lord knows there was hundreds of people there. And my two-year-old granddaughters, they love the goats, as my six-year-old granddaughter. But it was really a family time and the kids running around there. And I saw Bubby and I said, you know, this is a heck of a thing you do, opening this up for everybody for free. He obviously has to pay people. He has overhead involved. And he said it's his way of giving back. And if you haven't been to Christmas Town in a while, take time and go. Take your children, take your grandchildren. Just go if you don't have anybody to take. But it's very, very interesting, all his displays. I've been going for years, and it's amazing how much it's expanded. Thank you, Bubby. It's a good return to the people of St. Mary's County. And he and I talked. We go back many, many, many years. My dad knew his dad, and they were drinking buddies. But we talked about when we all started out, $50 a month for a place to do whatever we were trying to do, and
St. Mary's County was a different place 45 years ago. But there's some people who've done well. He's one, and he's giving back. Thank you, Bubby.
Todd?
Few things. First of all, I agree with Commissioner Hugh on what Bubby does. If you haven't been down to the farm, I go every year. It's a great not only opportunity to see the Christmas lights and the pageantry, but to see thousands of county residents as they wander on. So it's not over. It goes till Christmas. And don't be in a hurry if you're coming up Route 5 going on Flatiron Road, because you're not going to get there quick. And if you want to go speeding down there, trust me, the line will be from Flatiron Farm down to Route 5 to turn onto the road. So patience is a virtue. Which leads me to another piece, which is called Tis the Season. And we're into our Christmas season, and we had an early Thanksgiving and a little bit later Christmas. I'd like to say everybody out there, this is a very stressful time of year for a lot of people, for a lot of reasons, whether it be family or personal or whatever. The stress creates anger. We've talked about anger already. We'd like that to subside. Road rage. People don't know how to drive, and they decide they own the road. We're getting ready to open FDR Boulevard shortly. So what I'd ask everybody to do is, since it's the season, just take a deep breath and relax. You know, an extra 5 minutes isn't going to hurt anybody trying to get there. And think about the person next to you, not just necessarily about yourself. Which leads to Giving Tuesday, which is today. And as Commissioner Hewitt pointed out, what Bubby does for the community is a very giving thing. And if anybody knew how much Bubby really does besides the farm, I think he'd be really impressed with the amount of philanthropy and generosity that guy does for St. Mary's County, and nobody ever sees it. But today, let us think of others and not ourselves. So when you see the Toys for Tots box, stop and buy an extra toy and throw it in the box for some little kid. If you see an opportunity to give to one of our local organizations, such as the United Way was here this morning, give a little bit up. You know, it's about everybody else and not yourself, and today's a good day to be able to do that. The FDR Boulevard thing. I've sat here for 8 years when I started this project to get it built. We've got 0.72 miles down in 8 years. So I'm really happy that road is going to open shortly, and people are going to be able to see the advantage of getting cars off 235, the advantages to the base and everybody else. I drove it the other day, the road was out of the way, I went, wiggled down, things like that. It's going to be a nice road when it's done, and I think that the commissioners see a lot of opportunity for economic development along FDR Boulevard going into the future. So I would just ask Mr. Dietrich, let's finish the road, get it down to Peg Road where it belongs, and I can be really happy 4 years from probably about today when I sit in Commissioner Jarboe's seat saying, adios, amigo. and lastly, it is Tom's last day here, and he will get the last word. But I just want to say what a joy it's been working with him. I've known him and his family and the kids for years. Tom, we're going to miss you. You did a great job, and I'm sure our paths will be crossing again very shortly with the airport and all the expansion work out there. So with that, I want to thank you very much for everything you've done. And with that, thanks, guys.
Thank you, Mr. Morgan. I'd like to say, talking again about these Toys for Tots you just mentioned about, I belong to the Leonardtown Lions Club, and one of the things we do is we also collect toys, or we ask the community to do so. For those of you who might want to go by the True Value Hardware store, you'll see a tree in there that's got little tabs on there. And it's a gift for children that we have, our club has selected, using social services and everything here. And we try to fill those gift ideas. And along with Riken High School, also as a part of this, we go out just several days prior to Christmas and deliver these toys to needed families. And part of my joy is not only buying gifts for a couple of them, but it's also, I work with, since I have a pickup truck, is delivering these toys. And believe me, it sometimes breaks my heart, but it's gratitude that I have for my life and to see that I help some young kids really enjoy life. Because the view on their face when I show up with a bag full of these toys and deliver it is just, it's just a tremendous feeling. And so I'm asking for help to go out to True Value Hardware Store right here in Leonardtown. There's still some tags on that tree. And if you feel gifted, go ahead and take one of those, fill it,
And it tells you on there where to take the toys, or you can bring them to me, and I'll make sure it gets to our point of where we put all this together and deliver it that particular day, a couple of days prior to Christmas. So please open your hearts up again. Also, talking about gratitude, I was down vacationing in Emerald Isle for Thanksgiving. We spent Thanksgiving down there. Now, they was devastated by the hurricane that went through there in September. They're recovering. Unfortunately, on the 24th, we were there, and I was there discussing about trimming some trees, you know, with this tree man. When the storm came through there, a severe thunderstorm, it created a tornado, and the houses on A Street, which was only two miles away from us at that time, went across there and tore the roofs completely off of two houses. I'm talking about the entire roof tearing off. One of them so badly damaged that they're going to demolish the house. The thing of it is, the people had just recovered from the hurricane, just put a new roof and everything on, and other replacement stuff in there. They were in there getting ready to prepare for dinner when this thing hit. And the couple was just, luckily, just the husband and wife was there, had to run into an interior closet. They tore it and went across. They heard all this banging, glass breaking, everything. When they finally opened the door up, the whole roof was gone. Where they had been sitting, the rafters were laying on the sofa and the chair. We saw all this, and I said, oh, my God. And it within seconds, they'd moved to go into this closet. That's how quickly it hit. So I am grateful that we live in St. Mary's County. We don't have such severe weather some of these people are going through. And I count my blessings every day, and we all should. This is a great place to live. This is the last day of this current board. It has been a pleasure serving on this board. We've gotten a lot done. Commissioner Jarboe has been a big part of it. He has gone forth and has worked as hard as he can on economic development, especially developing around our airport. And initiating things along with the Navy to work together to improve our life here in St. Mary's County. Improvement, jobs, economic development is a key part of everything we do. We have been working hard to provide services for our people. That's where we are. I consider ourselves a big servicing organization, and my key is to provide the best service we can for our people. And I thank you, Mr. Jarboe, for all the work you've done.
I'm still a commissioner. Not a mister yet.
You're still commissioner? Okay, Mr. Jarboe. We'll call you Mr. Jarboe.
Everyone has been all my peers have been telling me, you're still honorable this week, but next week you'll be dishonorable.
No, you'll never be dishonorable. I'm almost sure that Commissioner Jarboe will be back again. He's done such a great job, and I know he's enjoyed it. And I do feel in years, like you say, you'll be coming back again, and we look forward to that and thank keeping you. St. Mary's County going. So thank you very much for all your work. For December, a new board meets. Well, I'll be sitting here with four returning and one new member. So obviously the people chose wisely. And we'll be pushing forward with our agendas. And yes, we will get FDR Boulevard completed. There's no doubt my mind will be a benefit. With nothing else?
Commissioner Jarboe.
Mr. Jarboe.
Oh, I get the last word. I love it. So people asked me today when I came in, they said, oh, my gosh, Commissioner, is your last day? Is it an emotional day? Of course it's emotional. It's so emotional that Commissioner O'Connor couldn't even bring himself to come to the meeting. If I had a dollar for every time I got called Commissioner O'Connor, I'd be a wealthy person. I don't understand how people confuse us all the time. I had some guy actually stop on my own road near my house and said, oh, Commissioner. And I was like, oh, he recognizes me because he was blocking the road. He's moving some stuff from Public Works, John, not point three. And he says, I know who you are. I said, okay, great. And he goes, you're John O'Connor. And I was like, Jesus, you could have just told it at Commissioner. We would have been fine. But no, he had to go the extra mile. I don't get it. He's a lot younger than me. But what's going to be really interesting for me is when Eric Colvin shows up because he's about the same age. So let's see if the two of them get confused all the time. I appreciate it. He's better looking than me and younger and better fit. So I'll take it. But confusion will set in. There's not going to be two O'Connors here. Thank you for my fellow commissioners for the kind words. Mike, I appreciate your considering me a wingman. We certainly worked a lot together on doing a lot of different things. Appreciate that. Todd, we've worked together and known each other for many, many, many years. So this is just another avenue that we've worked together. And yeah, you'll be hearing a lot from me working out at the airport for sure. Randy, I didn't know you from Adam when we first got elected. And the first meeting we had over at SAIC, we all kind of got together and tried to figure out who we were. And honestly, for the first 6 months, I don't know that we really integrated a whole lot. But when we started doing those trips to Annapolis, after you got through all the Vietnam War stories, I actually got to know Randy Guy, and I appreciated that, because I think we had an opportunity to really talk things through, and that's good.
We did.
So I appreciate all the support. We have a great county staff here, and I want to thank everybody on the staff for all the support you've given me over the last 4 years, and it's Christmas time. So here's what I want for Christmas. I want you guys to work together to be a cohesive board. Don't pick on Eric because he's the new guy and try to work with him and have integrate him, help him along. And what I really, really want for Christmas, which I think would solve so much, Bill, we need our own state fire marshal here in St. Mary's County. If we have to pay for it, who cares? Every project's being held up from the state fire marshal because there's one guy that does three counties. Can you guys talk to the delegation next week about funding a state fire marshal for St. Mary's County? That would be so much for this county.
That's the list.
On the list.
Excellent. And with that, thank you to the community for all your support. Commissioner, you're right. I will probably try to do this again, but I don't want to do this when I'm traveling so much internationally. But I will say, last dig at Public Works, it took you 8 years to do 3/4 of a road. You can go to the United Arab Emirates. They're creating an entire new country in the middle of the water. And the Chinese can certainly build up the Spratly Islands. So why can't we do more? We need to get through this and get this stuff done. So, and I'm mad that I'm going to miss the opening because I'm actually going to South America and leaving travel today. But I'm there in spirit. When you cut that ribbon, thank God we got that section open. Thank you to the community. That is all. Thanks.
With that said, the meeting adjourned.
For me.